Hello, I'm Ken Eads. I'm on the faculty here at the Darden School of Business, and this is the 2012 University of Virginia Investing Conference. And I have with me today our two speakers that form the energy session for the conference. To my left is Pierre LaPierre from Riverstone Holdings, and beside him is Kurt Bellick of Bocage Capital. And the two of them brought a lot of issues to light about a very important sector to our economy. And I'd like to open the questions. I'll start with Pierre. If you could just give me some of the dynamics of the industry and what are the forces that are involved now and that we should think about.
Great. Well, thank you, Ken. I would say that there are probably a few forces that are the most critical. One is we have what are commonly called production and completion techniques, which are the new advanced horizontal drilling and hydraulic fracking that has really turned the North American energy business from what I would say over the last 3 to 5 years was really a much more mature, low growth, high cost cash cow for the industry in terms of produce here, collect the cash, and then try to invest internationally overseas in much larger resource opportunities. With hydraulic fracking and horizontal drilling, we now have kind of an entire new resource base within the U.S. that we knew about, but we never could actually efficiently and productively produce. And so we've really turned the business from being more of a mature, slow growth business into one that's got quite a dynamic organic growth potential to it. That's sort of in the upstream side of the business, the actual drilling and producing of oil and natural gas. That has quickly followed on to dramatically change what we call the midstream infrastructure business, which is essentially the delivery system or the highway, if you draw the easy analogy, to how to move oil and gas around the country. And we now have a lot more production than we do infrastructure capacity, and so there's an enormous amount of capital going, you know, literally hundreds of billions of dollars going into both the upstream as well as the midstream in order to move a lot of this new resource efficiently and economically to someone who can use it.
Yeah. So, Kurt, is technology is a big play here?
Technology is absolutely critical here. You know, Pierre, I think, touched on really the high points of what's going on in the industry, where there has been this technological revolution really in the last 5 to 8 years that has completely opened up new areas for exploitation. But I think also equally interesting has rejuvenated old areas that we thought were in decline. You know, there are a lot of oil fields dating back to the 1960s, some even dating back to the beginning of the 20th century, which still have a lot of their original oil in place. And you can go back into these oil fields and gas fields and use these new drilling and completion techniques in order to rejuvenate these fields and greatly increase their productivity. And I think productivity is really one of the key issues in this industry right now. As we've seen in other technology revolutions, once you start working on a new technology, you become better and better at doing it. And so I think one of the things that we've really seen in the last 5 years that's really been quite profound is the cost of doing this has fallen dramatically. And while I think people are really aware of the technological revolution opening up new opportunities, I don't think they're quite aware of how much better we're getting at it over time. And I think we're still pretty early in the stage of implementing that productivity revolution. There's one other sector I'd also like to highlight. You know, Pierre talked about the upstream and the midstream, both of which are experiencing their own rejuvenation. But we think the downstream industries are exciting as well. The refining industry in the United States was pretty mature, pretty stagnant, and it's become much more profitable as a result of having both lower cost oil inputs, but also lower cost gas input to serve as the energy source for the refining process, has made the United States a very competitive refining center in the world today. And it's also led to the United States probably being one of the lowest cost chemical producers in the world. So we're pretty excited about the downstream opportunity as well.
Now, should I think a little bit about the upside of the potential technology in the terms of, even after going back and revisiting some of these existing fields, there's still going to be oil and gas left with the current technology, is there? So there's still the potential for even more extraction.
Absolutely, absolutely.
We just don't know how to do it yet.
Well, there's some techniques that we do know how to do. So, for example, to Kurt's point, taking whether it's a traditional conventional field, we're applying some of these new techniques to actually get reserves higher. I'd say that the typical, very general comment would be that when you have primary recovery in a conventional oil field, it might get 5 to 10% of the original resource in place. If you do CO2 flooding and water flooding, which are sort of secondary and tertiary recovery, you might get yourself up into the 30s historically over time. In the case of where we are on the unconventional or the shale or tight rock type opportunities, we're producing maybe 5-7% of the original resource in place with the technology we have today. There are opportunities to go back into those wells and essentially refrack them, create bigger openings to have more oil and gas flow, as well as to use potentially CO2 floods that were used on conventional fields very effectively, use those on fracked fields essentially. So there are lots of things. It keeps evolving, to Kurt's point. I think you'll see constant innovation and constant increases in the ultimate recovery from these wells over time.
And I think another exciting opportunity that really is only beginning to be discussed is that the geology of North America is not unique. There are fields that, tight rock formations like this all over the world. To date, we really haven't seen people trying to use these techniques outside North America. Mm. North America has a particularly dynamic oil field services and E&P sector that was able to really grab this opportunity. But more and more, we're seeing international oil companies and national and government-owned oil companies, the national oil companies, coming to North America, investing in the North American industry in order to learn these techniques. And so I think this has some pretty significant implications globally for the supply of energy in the future.
Good, thanks. Top of mind, let me start with Kurt. Winners and losers in this sort of going, not necessarily technology, but just in the energy.
Yeah, industry. You know, I think the biggest loser that we've really been able to identify, the biggest single loser, is the coal industry. And in particular, the coal industry in the central and southern Appalachian Mountains. It is probably the highest cost BTUs from a cost of production standpoint. And over the last 5 years, we've really seen gas displacing coal as the fuel of choice in the utility sector. I think there's still more coal-fired generation in North America, but it's coming pretty close to even in terms of market share. And the highest cost producers are the underground mines, some of the older mines in the central Appalachians. And I really think that that industry is going to come under a lot of stress. I also think that there's going to be some losers from companies that overinvested, that got too excited by the opportunity when it came out. And we saw a lot of people go in and pay very high prices for land, spend a lot of money on development very early on, and they did it on leverage. They borrowed money to do it. And then it turned out that as the industry collectively started to exploit this opportunity, the prices started to ratchet down. And so I do think there are some companies out there who have really incorrect financial structures. In terms of the winners, I got to go back to the refiners and to the chemical companies as being some of the big winners. And then I think some of the big winners are the companies that have been good stewards of capital, have found good entry points to use these new techniques. Often in older fields, we see some of the more high value investments actually being people who are using the older, these new techniques in older fields. And that's a pretty interesting business model to us.
Yeah. Different ones?
No, I would generally agree with Kurt. I would say clearly the people who on leverage bought at the peak of the cycle raw acreage have seen acreage prices in many of the major plays fall by more than half. And it's just time before that comes home to roost in terms of their ability to service that leverage. I agree with your comments on coal wholeheartedly. And I think the losers will ultimately be those that can't live in the cost structure of the business. And what I mean by that is scale, scope, and technical capability, like it has in other cycles or technological innovation within the energy business, ultimately wins out because we are a commodity business. At the end of the day, once we process into a usable product, whatever oil or gas from whatever basin, it gets used for roughly the same things and is priced as a worldwide commodity. In the case of oil and a domestic commodity in the case of gas. So everything that allows you to do that as efficiently as possible at a low cost ensures that you will survive, essentially. But I think the principal losers will be people who overextended the balance sheet, can't fund what they've already purchased, and in effect are going to lose that option.
And Ken, I think it's worth noting that another really big winner from all of this is the entire U.S. industrial complex. As a result of low-cost energy, the United States has really become the lowest cost energy area of the entire industrialized world. If you think about Asia or Europe, they have much higher energy costs. So U.S. manufacturers across the board are going to benefit from lower energy costs. As an example, U.S. Steel has mentioned that by substituting natural gas for coke in their blast furnace, they can cut about $15 a ton off of their cost of production. This represents about a 3% reduction in their operating costs, which doesn't sound like a lot, but is really quite significant in a commodity business like steelmaking.
It's good to end on a high note, so I want to thank Pierre and Kurt. Thanks for coming to the conference, and thanks for your comments.